Good morning. How's everybody doing? Man, did everybody enjoy the snow? Wasn't that beautiful? A lot of you are saying no to that. You fair-weathered fans. We have a snowdrift by our camper that's about that tall. I got drifts everywhere. It's plowing my driveway and snow blowing over the top of me. That's all about winter, right? It's all what winter looks like. Snow blowing over your face and Sheila sitting in the house doing her puzzle, watching it going, I'm not out there. Yeah, thanks a lot, Bob. Anyways, welcome to church. I don't know if Albany's on today, but if they are, good morning, Albany Nursing Home. We love you. Glad you're joining us today. Hope you enjoy the service. And those of you on Facebook that are watching today, I pray that God will bless you real good. Thank you for joining us. Would you stand with us this morning as Kat comes and leads us through the call to worship?
Is this yours or that hers?
Thank you.
Good morning. Our call to worship today comes from Psalms 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts and power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with dancing. Praise Him with the strings and pipe. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, thank you so much for bringing us together this morning so we can bring glory to your name, praise you, and just be with us as the worship team leads this congregation in praising you. Also be with Pastor Thomas. He brings this message. Such wonderful and amazing things that you're bringing in this place here, Lord. We're so grateful for you and everything that you do. In Jesus' name we pray.
Love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer.
Isn't that true? You may be seated. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Where else would you rather be than sitting in the presence of the King? Amen. I love him. I love him. You love Jesus this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
That's good stuff. I like that. Hey, I got a couple of announcements for you. Before we get too carried away with these things, I'm going to have Tina come up and share hers first. So, Tina, would you please come to the... I have to tell you.
I don't need a platform. All right, guys, we have a problem. Uh-oh. I need somebody who wants to earn $20 a week. $60. I wish you could. I have a lady here in Dunkirk who has, she's handicapped. I'm not sure what her handicap is. She talks funny, she walks funny, but I've never asked her what it is. And her boyfriend who lives with her is legally blind. And her dad is a truck driver out on the road. Now, they have two dogs. They have a blind dog, seeing dog, whatever you want to call those, and they have a comfort dog for her. She cannot get outside and pick up sticks or pick up poo-poo. She is asking for somebody to come to her house. She'll provide everything you need, the pooper scooper, the bags, everything you need, one time a week to come pick up poo-poo and sticks out of her backyard. That's all she needs. She's already got somebody to mow her yard, but she's got to get those picked up. If I could just find one young gentleman who would be willing to show Christ to this lady, what a wonderful, wonderful thing that would be. And it's $20 in to boot. She's a very nice lady. If you are willing to do this, please give me your number. Come give me your number, and I will give her your number, and she will contact you. I appreciate it if somebody could come forth and let God lead them into her door.
There you go. You know, there's a lot of ways that you can be Jesus to somebody, right? There's a lot of different ways that you can be Jesus. Sometimes just doing that, I guess, is a good way. Hey, this next Sunday, there'll be no Sunday night service, so just take note of that. We got a ton of stuff going on the 20th, right? New Hope Nazarene ministry meeting right after church. Take note of that, those of you that are on that committee. Nursing home service at 2 p.m. If you want to come over, I guess you can. Just have to wear a mask, right? Wear a mask. If you want to come over and join those people over there, it'd be great. And our Dorothy Bailey celebrated her 103rd birthday. Is that not crazy? She can't watch because they don't have the ability to watch it over there at the Miller's Merry Manor. But what would be really cool if you guys would all just send her a card or something, send her something, maybe a piece of candy. She already had chocolate cake, I guess. So you don't have to send her any chocolate cake. But she's 103. My goodness gracious. That's a lot. So, hey, let's celebrate her. You want to do that? Let's do that. Our board meeting's at 4:30 on the 20th also. Take note of that. 22nd of February is our spirit rally. Oh, community dinner. I'm sorry. We got to remember community dinner, too, on the 20th. Soup and sandwiches, right? Soup and sandwiches. Do you need people to get soup still? Pam, what all do you need? What all do you need?
Just desserts.
Just desserts? That's it. We got everything. You got everything, just need desserts. Well, there's your dessert right there. He already gave it to you right there. No, you're fine. You can do whatever you want. You're Pam, so you can do whatever you want. So, hey, remember that on the community dinner? Take note of that. Now, on the 22nd, is our spirit rally. What is that? Some of you are thinking spirit rally. Don't know. What happens that night is we go over to Muncie Southside at 6 p.m. and they serve us a meal. The church pays for everything. You don't have to pay for anything. So don't worry about that. You just have to sign up to go. We have to know how many are wanting to go to that. So if you could let Pastor Gloria know, either this Sunday or next Sunday, she'll write you down. You can put Sheila and I down for that. She'll write your name down and we'll get you signed up, okay? So take note of that. If you want to go, it's free. It doesn't cost you anything. And they got food galore, all you can eat fish, or chicken, I guess, whatever. Fish and chicken?
Yuck.
But chicken's good. So anyways, our food bank dates are February 10th to the 24th, the 10th and the 24th. Our food bank dates. Also, our community center giveaway, our food distribution, is the 14th of February. If you're interested in helping out with that, we never turn anybody down. See Pam? She'll get you signed up. She'll get you out there helping out. You know what, you guys? As we step out into the great unknown, and I'm telling you, we're stepping out of the great unknown, aren't we? And my sermon series starting this Sunday is called The Great Adventure. Because I believe that our church is on a great adventure right now. And I think we just need to saddle up our horses and get ready, right? Saddle up our horses and get ready. So the 14th is just another opportunity to serve our community, to show Christ to somebody, just to be Jesus. Gosh, isn't it cool just to be Jesus to people? I love it. So anyways, you have an opportunity there. And I think that's all of our announcements, other than Cheryl has one. And I'm going to have you come up here. Let's go. Two more announcements. What else we got? Ladies' Day, April 23rd. See Pastor Gloria for that too, if you're interested in going April 23rd. Oh, our 100-year anniversary of our church. We need 3 non-board members to help Greg and Tina put that together. So if you're interested, see Tina Elliott and Greg Dotson. You have 2. We need 1 more?
Yep.
All right.
Hello. I've got a bag here that's got all kind of goodies in it. And then this goodie is called a crisis care kit. And then there's toothpaste, toothbrush, hand towels, and fingernail clippers, and a little animal. And so we're filling them up this year. And I'm going to let you know that 2 of the boxes that we fill up, we're going to be giving to Kat for our homeless shelter that we're working on. So those that you bring today. But I just want to let you know they're out there. If you can't go shopping or don't want to go shopping, Pam, put your hand up there. Her and I love to go to the Dollar Tree. And we can spend 2 hours in there. If you guys don't want to go get stuff, give me the cash and we'll go get them and spend the day together, Pam. So, and now it's $1.25, but that's okay, we'll get it. Last year we filled up 42. So let's see how many we can fill up. So they're out there, and if you want them, if not, let me know and Pam and I'll go shopping.
Isn't that exciting? Two of our kits, that means 12 kits, will stay here for our home mission. Our home mission. Isn't that exciting? I think that's pretty cool. We're gearing up, aren't we? Kat has an announcement.
I do. And thank you all. That is so amazing, and God is just so good. But another announcement that we have that is Pastor Tom did set up a tithe donation portion on the Dunkirk Facebook site. Anyways, so anything that you are willing to give, we're so grateful for everything that has been given, not only the furniture, but the donations for clothes. And I mean, it has been incredible the amount of resources that have been given out of the kindness of everyone's hearts. And we're so grateful and appreciative.
We're almost to the point where we're actually going to be turning people away that are wanting to donate stuff to us because we don't have any room for it.
But there is a way that you can donate online through the Facebook Dunkirk Church of the Nazarene. There's a section for New Hope Ministry for online donations. So,
now as we take up our offering this morning, you can also go online and give to New Hope. Yeah, I was going to share that already. Anyways. No, there's no thunder to be stolen. I'm fine. But yeah, on our website, as you give online, there's a spot on there that you can give to this new ministry, and we have a fund set up already through our treasurer Kim, that money will just be dropped into New Hope, right into New Hope. So if you want to give there, you can. It's DunkirkNazarene.org online, or you can come up and drop it in the box up here. Your offering, not just for New Hope, for the church too, but it's great to give back to God. It really is. It's one of those things that we do as a church that just really blesses him and it blesses your church and our community as we go out and serve them. And we want to be the hands and feet of Jesus to everybody we meet, don't we? And this is an opportunity for us to be able to do that. So if you want to stand with us this morning, I'll pray. And I'll give this mic back to somebody who can handle it. Father God, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for your goodness to us and for the passion, Father God, that I can feel in this church today. Father, may the love of Christ be ever so evident in our lives as we give. May we give with a grateful heart. And may, Father God, may we give until, Father God, you say not to anymore. Just give and give and give, Father God, until you say, that's enough. We need to learn how to give till it hurts, Father. That's sacrificial giving. We love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for the blessing that you are. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Told me who I am.
Well, as we go into our prayer time this morning, the altar is open if you want to come and pray. You know, I would like to see three people that would just go to that altar, maybe four, at each one of the altars. Just come up and pray for this new ministry, if you dare. We're stepping out into something that's crazy, that you know, a lot of people, when we hear about it, go, what are you doing and what are you thinking? But Jesus has called us to a greater adventure, hasn't he? To a deeper thing. So I would like to just have one person go to each altar. Just spend some time praying for this new ministry. And maybe you got something on your heart that you need to lay down. You can come up here for that too. But I would just like to have four people just to step out and pray. So as this next song is played, it's called Your Name. It's a beautiful song. It's a strong and mighty tower. Just like our Jesus, right? A strong and mighty tower. So this morning, I'll just open up yourself to whatever God has for you this morning. Don't worry about who's standing around you or who might be looking at you. If you feel like you need to step out and come up here to pray, come up and pray. Because Jesus is calling us to do a greater thing. And he wants to do a greater thing in your life if you just open yourself up to him. So this morning, the altar is open. You come. Father God, for the call that you've placed on our hearts, Father God, for this new ministry. The call that you've placed on our hearts, Lord, to do great and mighty things, to step out into the great unknown, Lord. To dare to be different. To get in the flow rather than just walk by the river, Father God, as it goes by. There's no refreshing in that. Jesus is walking by the river. You have to get in to be refreshed. So this morning, Father God, we're stepping into the river, into the great unknown. Because, Father, we don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. And, Lord, some of these people we're going to be working with, Father, some of these wonderful, beautiful women, Father God, that are just had some tough times, Lord, and just, Father, I pray for them even right now. We have no idea who they are, their names, their faces, nothing. But we pray for them this morning, Lord, that your hand would be on them. Help them, Jesus. Father God, help us to be the church. Help us to be Jesus to those people we come in contact with. Help us to be Jesus, Father. We love you, Jesus, so much. And Father, for those at the altar praying, Father, most of them are up here praying for New Hope. But Father God, I pray if they're just up here for a request, Father, they have something in their hearts that they're dealing with, Lord, may you just touch them, Jesus. And Father, throughout this congregation, I'm sure there's somebody here this morning that say, I just need prayer. If you're here this morning, you just raise your hand. I need prayer this morning. Just pop it up. I want to pray for you this morning. I see those hands. Thanks. Father, you see the hands throughout the congregation. Lord, you know who they are. Father, touch them, Jesus. Speak to their hearts. Help them to see, Father God, their purpose and the plan, Lord, that you have for their lives. If it's a physical need, Lord, touch them in that. Father, if it's an emotional, spiritual, maybe it's in their relationship, Father. Maybe they need help in their relationship, Father God. Mend that. Father, one of the things I know about the enemy, Lord, he likes to get into our armor. He likes to find those cracks there in our armor and get in there, and Father, and try to destroy us. But Father, help us, Jesus, to be strong and mighty, warriors for Christ. We love you, Jesus, and we praise you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, kids. You're dismissed for children's church.
All I had to do today, another time around.
That's old school.
Yeah.
I love it. An oldie but a goodie. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
No. Are you ready?
Yeah.
To saddle up me. I'm so excited about this great adventure. I'm telling you. God is doing some great and amazing things. But I think that some of us need to understand what it's all going to really take. It's going to take for us, number one, to understand the adventure, right? To understand the journey. To get into the journey that God has called us to. Because a lot of times, again, like I said before, we get all excited. We want to jump into the deep end. We're ready to go. And all of a sudden, what's the old terminology? When the rubber meets the road kind of a thing? When the rubber meets the road, we go, wait a minute. This just got real. You mean, we're actually doing this? We're actually stepping out into the unknown? We're actually going to step out into the places and dealing with the people in the dark places that Jesus would go to?
Yes.
Do you understand that?
Yes.
Jesus didn't just hang out with the rich people. He didn't hang out with the you and the me's. He hung out with broken people. Some of his disciples were broken. Do you understand that? And the great adventure that God has us on. I'm so excited about this adventure. I'm so excited about what God is doing because I can hardly contain myself because I just want to go. Kat asked me, have I aged you, Pastor Tom? I said, no, actually, I feel 10 years younger. Because when you're in the flow, right? And when you're in the flow, have you ever been in the mountains? And there's a stream flowing, and you just put your feet in the stream, and you let that water run over you. How refreshing that is! That cool water coming off the mountain, and it's I don't go any further than about here, but because it's way too cold. But you know what I mean? It just cools you down, and that cool water is refreshing, isn't it? The cool water is healing. When you get into the flow of God's plan for our lives, there's healing in the flow. Did you know that? Because a lot of times, all the things that you were worried about, all the things you were dealing with in your life are way back here, and now you're stepping out into the great unknown going, all right, God, I'm in. All of a sudden, the water's flowing. All of a sudden, there's healing. In the midst of your brokenness, God is saying, I got you. Let's do this together. Let's get in. Let's get in and let's go. Because this is a bigger plan. It's a bigger thing. It's the great, guys, we are in the midst of the great adventure. Do you get that? And how exciting that is? Now, if you can't get excited about that, check your pulse, make sure you are still alive. Because I'm telling you, this is great stuff. We're in the midst of the great adventure. We're diving in. We're jumping in with both feet. And this morning for us, I want us to see that if the church is boring, it isn't God's fault and it isn't Jesus' fault. If you're here this morning going, you know, I came to church this morning, but you know, church is so boring, blah, blah, blah. It's not God's fault. It's not God's fault. It's not Jesus' fault. That only leaves one other person, right? You? Are you ready for a great adventure this morning? Are you ready to get excited about what God can do in your life? You know, there's so many pew Christians that just like to sit and listen and then go home after the sermon's over and go, what was it? What did he say? All I saw him was bouncing back and forth, jumping up and down, acting goofy. But you got to understand, I am just excited about what God is doing. Can you guys get excited with me?
Yes.
Can you get charged up? Has your battery been recharged? Have you been plugged in? Have you stepped into the stream this morning? Have you stepped into the stream this morning? Have you found healing in the movement of His Spirit? Oh, my goodness. May the Lord help us this morning, amen? May the Lord help us. Well, you can't get excited about this. I don't know what you get excited about. I don't know. And if you tell me it's next Sunday's football game, well, you got a problem. I want us to understand that what we're doing, what the church is doing, the church is moving. The church is moving. Did you know that the church is actually a living organism? It's a living organism. The church, the body of Christ. And what happens is, if you don't feed the body, if you don't give the body, if you don't refresh the body, if you don't give it water and do all that stuff, the body will die. Did you know that? Your physical body, if you don't feed yourself, you don't eat right, if you don't hydrate, if you don't do all those things you're supposed to do, your body will die because you're not giving it what it needs. And it's the same thing with the body of Christ. If you're not giving the body of Christ what it needs, if we're not doing everything that we can possibly do to make the body of Christ alive, we are causing it to die. And I don't know about you, but I don't ever want to be a dead Christian. I don't ever want to be part of a church that's just like, oh, well, whatever. I go every Sunday morning and I do my thing. No. We're not that church. We will not be that church. No. I was so encouraged after last week's service, I could barely control myself. I was so excited after last Sunday's service. I mean, I'm driving home going, you know, because it's like, oh my gosh, you guys get it. And you know what? You understand that when you move, when you moved. I sometimes go back and watch the video of you guys stepping out and coming up because that just touches my heart. Because you guys are, it makes me know that you are ready for this great adventure. I know you're ready. And men, let me tell you something. You may look at this and go, well, you know, the women are going to do this. It's going to be great with the girls and going to be able to hang on and, you know, knit and do all that. No. Men, you better get ready. You better get ready. There's going to be building that needs to be done. Can anybody swing a hammer? Can anybody in this room swing a hammer? Okay, don't stop. No, don't even. Because I know you can, and you can, and you can, and you can, and you, I know you can, and 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 as soon as your shoulder's ready, you can. Yeah, I know you can. There are things that we're going to have to do, and not just that part of it, but as Kat shared last week, there's going to be little boys that'll be coming to this that will need to have a positive male role model just to show them. So you're not off the hook, just so you know. It'll take every one of us in this room, then some, to make a difference. Back in the day when I was doing youth ministry, back in the day when we were doing youth ministry, there was a movement. There was a movement in youth ministry that talked about going mad for God. Just going mad for Him. And what that word, it was an acronym, MAD. And it meant make a difference. So I think we just need to go make a difference in somebody's life. I mean, you're right? Isn't that what God calls us to do? Is it going to make a difference? To step out into the great unknown? That place where you're uncomfortable? Is anybody uncomfortable? Probably all comfortable in here today. It's nice and warm. The chairs are comfortable. The pews are comfortable. They're all padded and everything like that. So you're probably comfortable right now. But I do believe that God wants us to get uncomfortable, don't you?
Yes.
I think He wants us to step out into the great unknown and get and find a place where we are uncomfortable. And maybe it's working with some of these little boys that'll be at this place. Maybe it's just doing something radical for Christ. Oh, I don't know about you, but I just want to be crazy for Jesus. You see, when you look at life, the life of Jesus, you know that His life was anything but dull, wasn't it? It was anything but dull. It was anything but boring. That wasn't what he was about. That wasn't what he was about. No. It wasn't. It was a great adventure. Think about where he went. No, the call to Christ, the follow Christ, the call of faith, was a call of a life adventure. I don't think what we typically think of our faith as in those terms, at least not often enough. But the Bible certainly does. Shame on us if we miss it. Shame on us if we miss the idea of this great adventure. You know, because I think God calls us to a great adventure, don't you? I don't think he calls us to just be pew potatoes, for a better use of term. Right? Because if you're a pew potato, your roots are going to grow down, and you're going to get stuck. You'll just get stuck. That's what potatoes do, right? You plant and they go down, and you're like, I'm a potato. I don't want to be a potato. I don't want to be that. I want to move. I want to go. When Jesus walks by, I want to go, oh, wait a minute, I'm in the flow. Right? Don't you want to be the flow of Christ as he moves? Pastor Tom, you want to calm down a little bit? Nope. I'm not going to do it. I don't think we look at our lives, our spiritual lives, our Christian life, as a great adventure enough. I think we get comfortable in what we've been doing, that anything new makes us go, okay, Pastor Tom, are you all right? We need to do this. Shame on us if we miss it. Way before Captain Jack Sparrow, way before Indiana Jones, and way before Roy Rogers and John Wayne, even way before Errol Flynn. How far back do I need to go? Errol Flynn. Do you know who Errol Flynn is? Before Robin Hood, King Arthur, Ulysses, way before the great adventure, that little boy's dream. The account of a real-life adventure was found in the page of this book. Throughout this month, we're going to be dealing with this great adventure sermon series. We're going to be dealing with this. And we're going to be looking at people like Abraham and Noah and Moses and Joshua and David. But that is some larger-than-life extraordinary superheroes, no? Rather than as the Bible presents them, as ordinary people who God called to a great adventure. Ordinary people just like you and me. And God says, go. God says, go. Saddle up your horses. We have a trail to blaze. We have some place to be this morning. Saddle up your horses. We have a trail to blaze. That was another thing they used to call us, trailblazers, right? Remember back in the day they called us trailblazers? Christians were trailblazers. Why? Why were we called trailblazers? Anybody know? You mean you were called that? You didn't know why you were called that? Because God's plan for our life was to blaze a trail, to lead people to Christ, to find them on your path of your journey and show them Jesus. That's why we're called trailblazers. You're supposed to blaze the trail, find those that are lost, and help them to find their way back home. I'll calm down after I die. This is my point. I believe that God calls each of us to a great adventure of faith, don't you? Each of us to a great adventure of faith. The call to follow Christ is an invitation to a radically new life full of change, excitement, surprise, and opportunity. And I believe that if we truly believe that and appreciate that, it would make a difference not only in our church, but even in our personal walk with Christ. If we truly believe that each one of us in this room are called to a great adventure, it would change us, wouldn't it? It would change us. Like I told you, I feel 10 years younger thinking about what God is doing. I should be tired. I should be just worn out because Kat just keeps calling and texting and bugging me. Nick, can you do something? I mean, I know. But you know what I mean? I should be exhausted. but I am energized. Oh, after last week's service, I mean, I was like, oh, man, just that vibrancy of the Christ moving. And I don't know about you, but man, that just really touched me. It got to me. I'm ready to go. Are you ready? Are you ready to be radical? I know you are. But are you guys ready to be radical for Christ? Just to be crazy for what God is doing and how He's moving and how He's changing and challenging us? Are you ready to get on? I mean, oh my goodness. The train is moving and I'm ready to go. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 11 this morning. This dude Abraham. He's pretty cool, isn't he? Abraham's pretty cool. It says, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would rather later receive as inheritance, obeyed and went. Listen to this. Even though he did not know where he was going, Abraham had no clue what his adventure was going to look like. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in foreign country. He lived in tents. I'm sorry, I should be giving you this. There's that. Okay, here we go. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who are heirs with him to the same promise. He was looking forward to a city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. Whose architect and builder is God. The Hebrew writer is summarizing the great story of Abraham. If you go back to Genesis 12, where he's first introduced to us, you'll find that he's already 75 years old back in the book of Genesis. He's already 75. When God first calls him. Some of you are sitting here going, man, I'm 74, I'm 75 years old, I'm 80 years old, I'm 86 years old, I'm 87, whatever you are. Abraham started his ministry, he was 75 years old. So all of you that are older, no more complaining about how old you are. Get on board. If Abraham can do it, so can you. And he tells him to go. He tells him to go and leave everything that he knew. Everything that he knew. And he doesn't even tell him where he's going. He has no idea where he's going, but he tells him to go. He has no idea where God is leading him. He doesn't even know where he's going. But he goes, doesn't he? Now, what kind of challenge would that have been? How ready do you think Abraham probably was to move? Or how set in his ways do you think he might have been? You know, at 75 years old, some of us get set in our ways a little bit, don't we? Some of us don't like change. Even at 58 years old, some of us are still kind of locked in to some of the things that we believe and feel good about and trust. Right? It's okay to be honest. It's okay to nod your head like this. If I'm right. Sometimes even at the age of 30, we get locked into these ideas that this is all there is and this is all I want. Right? It's really easy to do. It's really easy to do because moving and doing something different and changing, it's a big thing. It's a big deal. Because we're not ready for it, are we? Think about Abraham. God just said, you know, Abraham, I got a better idea. Let's go. Pack up all your stuff and let's go. And he did it. But the kicker here is in verse 8. You ready for this? He obeyed and went. He just obeyed and he went. He didn't go, wait a minute. I gotta tie some things up over here. I gotta go over here and do this, and I gotta call my mom and let her know I'm gonna FaceTime her, my mom, and I'm gonna let her know what's happening and everything like that. At 75 years old, his mom probably wasn't around anymore. But anyways, you know all that. And sometimes we have these excuses, don't we, that we make for all the things that we can't do. All these things. Oh, you know, I'm on my back, my arm, my knees. Oh, you know what? I got something going on that day. What day? Whatever day this is happening, I got something going on that day. Right? Right? It's kind of funny. I was telling Kat, you know, all the things. See, I made a mistake And I forgot how many Facebook friends I actually have. And I posted on my Facebook page that we were looking for couches and beds and chairs and that kind of stuff like that. And it blew up. It blew up. And like I said, we're probably going to have to turn people away because turn people down because we only have so much room. Yeah, we only have so much room for stuff. And people are like, oh yeah, I got couches and chairs. We're getting a brand new bedroom so you can have this. And it's like, slow down. Wait a minute. What have I done? But I think people get excited about stuff that's new. People get excited about the movement of God's hand. I think people get excited about that. Even some of our young people in our church are going, I want to be part of that. I want to be part of that. Because this is something that God is doing. And God is moving. And I just want to be part of that. Something that 15 years down the road, you could see where God moved and you jumped in and where your life is different because of it. Whew, that's good stuff. He disobeyed in what? There doesn't seem to be any discussion about it. Again, oh God, thanks, but I'm too old. Or you pick one of those young folks, they're the future, I've done my part. You know how many times I've heard that? Hey, you pick somebody else to do it. I've done my part. I've served the church. Some 50 years I've served the church. You know what? You better start thinking about serving it for another 50. Because if you don't, you're not part of the solution. You're actually part of the problem. Man, that's tough teaching, isn't it? I'm glad I didn't give you guys tomatoes when you walked in this morning. That would have been the natural response. But Abraham faithfully obeyed and he goes. Even though he doesn't know where he was going, he had no idea where God was leading him. No clue where God was moving. He didn't know what the outcome was going to be. He wasn't given a roadmap with all the stops clearly marked. He had, if he had, I wondered what he would have done. Do you think he still would have gone? He would have known he was going to nowhere? He just obeyed and went because that's what God said to do. He just obeyed and went. And I have to tell you know what? As your pastor up here, standing before you today, I have to say that I'm sorry. Because I had in mind that this place was going to be a church, and I was stuck on that idea and stuck on that concept and stuck on that vision and that idea. And God had a whole new plan in place. One of the things I've been learning as a pastor, that God just doesn't use me to lead. He uses you too. He uses you too. Because I would have never thought about doing what we're doing. Ever. That wasn't even on my radar. Wasn't even close. My idea was to call Pastor Tim and tell him, forget about it. We can't do this. We're done. That was my step, the next step. That was my plan. So let Pastor Tim know that, you know, this isn't going to work. We can't do this. But all of a sudden, God just moved. All of a sudden, God just moved. All of a sudden, it wasn't about what I wanted to do. It was about what God wanted to do. And at times, don't you think we get in His way? And I think I was in God's way. I was in God's way as the authority of the church in Dunkirk, Indiana, as the pastor of the church, as somebody who stands in authority. I was actually in God's way of doing what He wanted to do. And the minute I stepped out of His way, it blew up. Because that's what God does. He just makes things happen. Once, and the sad thing about it is I've preached to you guys about just getting out of God's way. Haven't I? I've said it many times. Yeah, I was in his way. And until I decided to get out of his way, he couldn't move. So I want to let you know that I'm sorry for that. I apologize. And you too, Father. I already apologized to him, but I will in front of you guys too. Because I think it's going to be a great thing. Because he just obeyed and went, because that's what God told him to do. And when he got there, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. Have you ever ended up somewhere where you never in your wildest dream thought you would be? I mean, don't, because that just says you got lost. I mean, because you were exactly where God wanted you to be. You ever, that ever happened to you before? You're going somewhere and all of a sudden it's like, why am I here? Because God put you there. You see, when you answer God's call, it's no telling where you might end up. When you answer God's call, there's no telling where you might be. In spring of 2009, I had been praying that God would show me where he could use me. I'd been working at the hospital all these four and a half years. I've been working at the hospital. I just asked God. I said, God, there's got to be something more. Not that this chaplaincy isn't great, but I love it, but you know, and these people, but Father, I just need to serve. I need to serve. And all of a sudden, I got a call from a friend, Bill Keene. You guys all know Bill. Some of you do, anyways. He told me about a little church in Dunkirk, Indiana that was looking for a preacher. And I remember telling him two things. Number one, I'm not a Nazarene pastor. And two, where in the world is Dunkirk? Literally, those are the two questions I asked him. I said, number one, I'm not a Nazarene pastor. I'm ordained in the Wesleyan Church, blah, blah, blah. And where is Dunkirk? Had no clue. Of course, we all know what the outcome of that was, don't we? 12 years later. Now I am tired. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. No, because you know what? I believe God puts us on these great adventures. Yes. Hasn't it been a great 12 years?
Yes.
Okay, hasn't it been a great 12 years? Come on.
Yes.
Help a brother out.
We'll let you know Thursday.
You know Thursday? What's Thursday? Food pantry. No, it's been a great adventure, hasn't it? It's been wonderful. And you know what? We've gone from where we were to where we are now. And it's been a crazy ride. It's been a crazy ride. Of course, all of that doesn't even compare to the challenges that Abraham was on, what Abraham was doing. It doesn't even come close to comparing. And Genesis also tells us when Abraham left Haran, he took everything with him. He took his wife, Sarai, his nephew, Lot, and all his possessions he accumulated, and the people that he acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Now, why didn't he just pack an overnight bag? Why didn't he just pack enough clothes for a week? Why didn't he just say, you know what, I'm just going to do this? You know, it's like, all right, we'll go there for a month, like the people do in Florida. We'll go there for a month and hang out there for a month, and we'll just come back home. He was planning on never coming back. He's planning on never coming back. There was no plan B. There was only plan A. There was no backup plan. Nowhere does it say, okay, God, I'll give it 6 months, and if it doesn't work out, I can always come back. No, when he left, he left. When he left, he left. You guys, we might start this up and not have anybody show up for a month, 2 months. And we might find ourselves discouraged going, well, this was a dumb idea. Let's just call it quits and be done with this. No. We have to stick to God's plan. We have to stick to God's plan. And you know what? I will fight you. Not physically, but verbally or whatever I need to do. To make sure that that happens. Because we will not give up on God's plan. We will not give up on God's dream. We have to stand fast. We have to stand fast, don't we? How many one-way tickets have you ever purchased? How many times have you completely put yourself in God's hand and said, God, I'm ready. I'm really ready to commit to this. And I know there's no going back. I've told you my story about going up to Michigan, moving to Michigan. I've told you that story. There was no turning back. We said yes, and we went. 3.5-4 hours away from our family, we just left. Packed up everything in our house, still owned the house that we lived in, packed up everything we had, moved to Michigan in faith, knowing that God had called us there. We just moved. Crazy. I'm making a mortgage payment on a house I don't even live in. I live in Michigan. At least I thought it was going to be. Because the minute I said yes, God sold my house. The minute I said yes, God gave me a house in Michigan. We just have to be willing to say yes and get out of His way. Taking up the call of God requires commitment. There ought to be any idea of going back. Abraham didn't. There should be any idea of going and saying, you know what? We're going to move back. This is a dumb idea. We weren't thinking this through. You know, that moment when you panic, you know? We weren't thinking this through. We've gone all this way, but you know what? We have to. No. Ever happened in your life? Where you get to a point and we say, what are we doing? This is crazy. There's no way this will work, right? There's no way this is going to work. I don't have the skills. No, but God does. I don't have the talent. God does. I don't have that. We can't finance it. Don't worry. God's got that. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. And when he got to the promised land, what did he find? Nice, friendly neighbors like himself and his family who invited him and Sarah over for barbecue. You think that's what he found? No, that's not what he found when he got to the promised land. He found Canaanites. And guess what the Canaanites were like? They were heathens. They were awful, awful people. They weren't nice. They were the kind of people that he was used to being back around home. They didn't look the same. They didn't eat the same types of food. They didn't wear the same types of clothes. They didn't listen to the same kind of music. Their skin was different. Their culture was so completely different. Even their values were different. They didn't share the same respect for human life. They worshipped idols. But God instructed them to go. And they went. We're going to run into all kinds of different people, folks. All kinds of different people. Can we love them? Can we show them Jesus? Can we be the hands and feet of Christ? Can we have His heart? Can we have His heart? Can we have His eyes? Can we love them through their brokenness? Can we love them through the decisions and choices that they've made that brought them to the situation that they're in? This is the great adventure, folks. This is the great adventure. Because you don't know what's at the promised land. You don't have any idea. We don't have any idea what this is going to look like, what's going to happen. We just have to say, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. I will follow you anywhere you lead me. I will dare to be different. I will go mad for you, Jesus. I'll make a difference. You should write that in your Bible somewhere. Go mad for Jesus. Go make a difference. Write that in your eye. Write it down somewhere. Maybe I need to put one of them sheets for you guys to put on your refrigerators again, right? Go make a difference. Be different. God instructed him to go, and Abraham went and lived among these strangers in a foreign country. He lived among them. He became part of them. Why do we go to Honduras? Why do we send missionaries out? Why do we do these things? Why do we send money? Why do we send people? Why do we go? Why do we do the things that we do? For all the world missions throughout the world. You know, we send money to different places. There's a church over in Bluffton, our Nazarene church in Bluffton, that sends thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. Why do we do it? Because God said so. Because God said so. He told Jonah to go to Nineveh. Nobody liked the Ninevites. You thought the Canaanites were bad. Abraham would just be glad he didn't get sent to Nineveh. Of course, we all know that Jonah did his thing and still went. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 11 says this. By faith. I could stop right there. By faith. It says, Abraham, even though he was past the age and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and as good as dead, 75 years old, came and ascended as numerous as the stars in the sky and countless as the sands on the seashore. Life is full of surprises, isn't it? Life is full of surprises. How do you think that this one went over with old Abraham and Sarah? Oh, they wanted children, had for years. But don't you think they had probably given up by now? The text is discreet here. Past age is what it says. He was past age. He was old. And she was no spring chicken. Think about it. In Genesis, 75 years old when he left. So by now he's at least 100, right? He's at least 100. How many of you at 100 years old want to be chasing around a rugrat? I mean, come on, seriously. 100 years old, you want to... Where's Jackson at? I want to show you. How many of you at 100 years old want to be doing that? But here's Abraham and Sarah. At least 100. Having a child. God's got a sense of humor, doesn't he? Don't you know that he had to shock their system? Don't you know this had to rock their world? Do you understand that having children changes your world, changes your life? Anybody know that? You know that? It changes your life? Having children? Makes things different? It'll rock your world, won't it? I remember when we had Chris. We weren't ready for that. It changes who you are. It changes your life. And now we get our grandkids. We have this little guy named Jake. He's about that tall. And he could power a small city with all of his energy. And 58-year-old grandpa has to chase this kid around. And blah, 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 grandma, I can't tell you what her age is. She looks like she's 35. Because I treat her so good, that's why. Chasing around Jake. It changes who you are. I remember we'd go to movies when I wanted to, stay out late, go to restaurants, people invite us over to their homes, not have to worry about anybody breaking anything. When we had our three children, guess what? People stopped inviting us over to their house. When we had our three children. Actually, when we had two, they're like, nope, you don't have to come over. You can stay home. Nah, 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 we're good, we're good. Just have us over for, no, we didn't have any over for dinner either. Nope. Life changes. And here's Abraham and Sarah, 100 years old at this time, but to be about to be parents, talk about an adventure. God called Abraham, and he called him to a great adventure, a faith beyond anything he could even imagine. Is that any different for us? Doesn't he still call us to adventures? Does he still call us? Do you still believe that God calls his people? Yes. Is Abraham really any different from us? No. He's a normal person. Abraham certainly would go on to be the father of Israel, the great patriarch through whom God would form his chosen people, but the Bible is pretty honest about his failings. On more than one occasion, he lied to Pharaoh. At one point, he and Sarah tried to circumvent God's plan for their children bearing with a maidservant. which, by the way, creates all kind. Created all kind of family dysfunctions down the road for them, didn't it? It caused all kinds of problems. But God still used him. I want you to hear this. You may look in the mirror and see that reflection and go, you have no value. There's nothing about you that's worth anything. Maybe you look in the mirror and go, you know, you can't do anything for God. You're a sinner. You live a life of just blatant sin. You can't do anything for God because you fill in the blanks. Because don't we have all the excuses written down somewhere? You can't do anything for God because I live too far away. I can't. The church is too far away from my house. I can't do anything for God because you're too far away. I can't. Enough of the excuses. It's enough of the excuses. If God can use Abraham, he can use you. When you look in the mirror, you need to see that person. You need to see that person that go, God can use you. Even a crinkled $20 bill is still worth $20, isn't it? A crinkled $100 bill is still worth $100. In your brokenness, in your life, when God looks at you, he sees nothing but value. He sees the beauty of your holiness. Even in the midst of your brokenness, he sees your beauty. Men, you may think that that's like, well, Pastor Tom, he doesn't see my beauty. Yeah, he does. When I look in the mirror, you know, I go, whoa, hey, you know. You ever feel like you have to sneak up on a mirror because it's like, you know? God's, that tickled somebody, didn't it? God sees you in your beauty. He sees you in your perfection. Because he has made you perfect. If you're a sinner, just stop sinning. Confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive. Right? Just confess. Get right with him. Don't live in that anymore. See the beauty that God sees. He can use you to do great and amazing things. Because trust me, if he can use me, he surely can use you. Right? I told you about my stuttering problem. Back when I was a kid, even in high school, I stuttered bad. Who'd have thought I'd be up here preaching today? God can take your brokenness. He can take everything that's wrong with you. And of course, you probably see a lot more than he does. We're kind of hard on ourselves sometimes, aren't we? He could just use you to do great things. God still used him. None of us are perfect. But God can still use each of us as well. God calls us to his great adventure. I needed to give you these, doesn't he? Doesn't God still call us people to adventures? He does, doesn't he? He still calls us to great adventures. Sorry, I didn't give you these answers. I got carried away. I'm sorry. God calls us to his great adventure. He calls us to his great adventure. Jesus said this, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full in John 10:10. Maybe we don't fully grasp what God is calling us to. This morning I want to suggest to you that God has called you into his glorious kingdom, and as it is life of challenge, excitement, sometimes surprise, and sometimes adventure. He's called us to a life of challenge, right? A life of excitement, sometimes a surprise. Has God ever surprised you with what he's called you to be and called you to do? He sure has me. But you got to let him. You got to let him. You gotta see. You gotta just put away all those feelings of worthlessness, all those feelings of I can't do's, because you know what? You can't do, but he can. He can. Did I ever think I could actually be a youth pastor? No. No way. raised in a Catholic family. Mom from Italy, dad German, Irish background. I was Catholic through and through. But God puts people in your life and puts you in places in your life, and he goes, look, you can do this. No, no, not through you, but through me. At 22, 21 years old, Sheila and I were leading youth ministry. And it grew and it grew and it grew. The next thing you know, right? The next thing you know, the next thing you know. No, you can't do it. Because it's not you that's doing it, it's him. So what is your life like this morning? You feel like it's just boring and dull, and you just go through the motions, and you know, I get up in the morning, and you know, you got your pattern, you got your plan, you go do this, you go do that, and next thing you know, you get home, you know, you go, da, 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 da. You know what? God doesn't call you to that. He calls us this great adventure. He calls us this greater thing he wants to do. It's a greater thing, isn't it? It's a greater thing. And you know what, guys? I'm going to side note this, and I'm not even talking about New Hope Ministries. I'm not even talking about that, just that. There's other things that God calls us to that we just have to learn how to say yes. There's so much more of the Christian life than there are to these 2 hours on Sunday morning. Too much that God would have us do right here. So I want to just suggest to you that God has called you into his kingdom, his glorious kingdom of adventure. Jesus said, I have come, they may have life, they have it full. If you've been bored in your Christian walk, ask yourself why. It isn't God's fault, and it isn't Jesus' fault. If you just ask him to show you and to lead you, to tell you where you might, where he might take you. Saddle up your horses and get ready. Because when you ask him, if you ask him, when you ask him, hopefully you will ask him, you better saddle up your horses and get ready, because God's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for me. He's got a plan. We just have to be willing to say yes. It's time you ask him what adventure he's got in store for you. If you'd stand with me this morning as we close out our service, I hope you guys hear my heart this morning. You hear my heart. I love you, but it's time to stop being bored and bored in your relationship with God, isn't it? Yes. It's time for some excitement in your life. And this morning, it's time for a great adventure. Amen? If you're here this morning, you'd say, Pastor Tom, I just want God's best for my life. I want God. I want to follow his plan. I want to just be part of what he's doing in the moving of his spirit. If that's you this morning, I'm going to be praying for you that God would find a way to, number one, open your eyes. Number two, provide an opportunity for you to just go crazy for him. To go mad. Go make a difference. Father, we love you, Jesus. Thank you for who you are. Lord, you are awesome. You're great and you're amazing. And Father, this morning, I pray as we leave this place, Father God, that you would just really bless us, bless those that are here, and Father, may you find us faithful in our following of you. We love you, Jesus. Dismiss us now with your grace and your love. In your name we pray. Amen.